So good afternoon, and thank you for staying for this presentation to discuss the treatment in stage 3 colon cancer. It is the most important medical oncology that we can do in colon cancer. In stage 1, medical oncology has nothing to do. In stage 4, we can increase the survival of the patients. In stage 2, there is a debate if we should treat or not the patient, but in stage 3, we can cure patients. So that's why I believe it's the most important communication. So I will briefly discuss the state of the art and try to make complex the answer to give oxaliplatin-based chemotherapy. That should be the normal answer. So, as you know, the history of adjuvant treatment in colorectal cancer started in 1990 with Muertel and 5-FU plus levamisole. This paper has shown an improvement in progression-free survival in stage 3 by 41% and in the survival of 33%. The second step went 14 years after that with the addition of oxaliplatin to 5-FU and leucovorin, with first the results of the MOSAIC trial, followed by CO7, the FLOX regimen, and then the last one was the Xelox, published by Haller in 2001. So the efficacy of the three different regimens used in MOSAIC, CO7, and Xeloxa trial are almost the same, with a benefit in patients with stage 3, between 6.3% and 7.5% in progression-free survival, and 3.4 to 4.2 in overall survival. We had this special finding in the MOSAIC study that the benefit might increase with the severity of the disease in patients with stage 3C at that time with more than 4 positive lymph nodes. The absolute benefit is more than 10%. We have some differences between the different regimens in terms of safety, with more hematological toxicity with oxaliplatin, more GI effects with FLOX or Xelox. FLOX is giving more risk to the patient, especially to elderly patients, and cannot be recommended. We had, since this second step in 2004, the disillusion of the targeted therapies. I will not show the results of the negative trials with bevacizumab, either the CO8 and the AVANT trial, as well as for cetuximab with NO147 and PETAC8. So what can we do to improve these results? We can look at biomarkers. And you know the biomarkers for stage 2, including MSI that had been presented before. In stage 3, we lack this biomarker, except here in this study, the SMAD4. However, just to show that, to repeat what I've said, Julien Taïeb, about MSI or the DMMR patients in the trials, there is a detrimental effect in stage 2, but not in stage 3 with fluoropyrimidines. And when you use oxaliplatin, as been shown in the MOSAIC trial this year at ASCO, there are very few relapses in the patient who are deficient in mismatch repair if they are stage 3. So there is some new issues in the subgroups of patients that enter in the trial with oxaliplatin in the adjuvant setting. We had the issue of the elderly patients. Elderly patients, it came from the meta-analysis of ACCENT, combining the results of MOSAIC and the results of CO7, showing that combining these two trials, there were no benefit in terms of DFS and overall survival for the addition of oxaliplatin. But these trials are really different in patients over 70 years of age. In MOSAIC, I will discuss the results. The detrimental effect is certainly not observed, while it is present in CO7, where there is an interaction between the age and the treatment. In the Xeloxa trial that came later, there is a benefit. The benefit is of less magnitude than in a younger patients, but it's still positive for the elderly patients. So looking back at Mosaic, this has been published in the JCO 2010, the results, we observe in the patients over 70 years that these patients are still the benefit in relapse-free survival. But they lose their benefit in disease-free survival at around 5 years of follow-up. So it means that the reason why DFS stop is not a relapse. It's death of other causes. And it is the same for the survival curve. And looking so this effect, what happened? In the patients who relapse, survival, like shown in the PETAC 3 paper, but here it's for all the patients who were exposed to the most active regimen did very poorly after their relapse. Why they did poorly? Maybe it's biologic, but it's also certainly because they have received a less intensive treatment, less patient had surgery, less patient had an active treatment when they relapse. So the median survival in this patient post-DFS is only 4.4 months if they have received the FOLFOX as adjuvant treatment. It's more than 1 year if they have received 5-FU. And looking at the subgroups in Mosaic, in the elderly patient, you see the gender effect, for example. The benefit is certainly not observed in male patients, but it's observed in women. In women, they keep their benefit. Why? Because in Mosaic, we treated patients until 75 years of age. So we have a group of male patients, 70 to 75, and a group of female patients for 70 to 75. Obviously, at this age, the male population is not doing as well as the female population, even if they do not have any cancer. So the risk of problems other than colon cancer occur here, and mostly in male patients. Also, we can look at the subgroup of Mosaic of the patients with more than 4 positive lymph nodes, the old stage 3C classification. And here, they keep their benefit either in disease-free survival or in overall survival, even if the subgroups are very small. The benefit is 17% in disease-free survival, 18% in overall survival. I've shown the result previously of in the stage 3C in Mosaic, the benefit was something like 12%. So this patient keep a benefit being treated by FOLFOX in a adjuvant setting. So based on this data, plus other, I will try to give you a decision algorithm to treat the patient with stage 3. So we can go back to the patient. Patients want an adjuvant treatment if it can help and decrease the risk of relapse and the risk of death. So this is a paper shown in at ASCO in 2007 asking the patient what they would like as benefit to be treated. So when the cure rate is approximately 5%, they would accept the benefit of 3% the benefit of 5% in 68% of the patients and 10% 88%. When the cure rate without oxaliplatin is 80%, for a 3% benefit, a majority of patients would still want to receive an adjuvant treatment. So clearly, based on this slide and this work, I believe that if we can give to the patient a benefit over 3%, then oxaliplatin-based therapy should be considered. So then we will look at the new AGCC classification, looking at the subclassification according to the number of lymph nodes, and applying this new classification to the SARE data with the hazard ratio observed for the addition of oxaliplatin. So doing that in the stage 3, we can have some subgroup who have a very good prognosis and in which the benefit of oxaliplatin will never reach 3%, like the T1, T2, N1A, and so on. You have a group where the benefit is between 5 and 10%, most of these patients, and those who have a huge benefit, the patient with stage 3C, who have a benefit over 10%. So this is a way to find the mark of 3% where the patient should be treated. We can also look in Mosaic with the new AGCC classification. Unfortunately, based on the criteria of SGCC, some patients could not be stratified according to the SGCC population. But in the patient who could not be classified, you have this difference between 5-FU and oxaliplatin, showing a benefit of oxaliplatin. That is what was expected in the whole group of patients. Of note, most of these patients belong to the stage 3B group. Now, looking at the full IGCC classification in the mosaic patient, here you have the classification in the stage 3A. First, the stage 3A do not do as well as in the SEER database, because here with 5-FU, the overall the disease-free survival is less than 0.8. And FOLFOX is doing well in this subgroup. In stage 3B, on the other hand, we see no benefit. But here, again, I could not give the full IGCC classification in a large number of these patients. So you can guess it's halfway between the first slide and this slide. And in stage 3C, new definition of stage 3C, you see the huge benefit of giving oxaliplatin-based therapy as adjuvant treatment. So what we observe also in the adjuvant setting is a Will-Rogers effect. This is striking, comparing what we have in Mosaic and Avant. You have here the results observed for the 3-year survival in the different trials with oxaliplatin, showing Mosaic on the left and Xeloxa, more recent trial with a better 3-year overall survival, and those observed in N0147 and Avant, which looks even better. And comparing the Mosaic with FOLFOX4, the same regimen, FOLFOX4 in Mosaic and FOLFOX4 in Avant, we move from per 3-year disease-free survival from 73% to 77% in stage 3 patients, 5-year overall survival from 76% to 85%, even if here the result can be considered as preliminary. 3-year disease-free survival in patients with less than 4 lymph nodes, benefit of 14% and 10% 3-year disease-free survival with more than 4 lymph nodes. So we have certainly a Will-Rogers effect, and the survival that we have now in our control arm is really impressive compared to what we have before the ARIA chemotherapy. So here can be the decision algorithm using the new AGCC classification. You have the patient who have a risk or benefit of oxaliplatin of less than 3%. It means that their risk of relapse is less than 15%. We have an intermediate group where the benefit is between 15 and 25%. The benefit is over 3% for oxaliplatin, but the absolute risk will be reduced by 15 to 25%. And those who have a risk decreased by 25%, the potential benefit over 5. So these are mostly the first that belong to the stage 3A. The second, most of these patients belong to the stage 3B. And the patients at high risk are one part of the stage 3B. And all the stage 3C. And I will add to this group the elderly patients, at least the male patients below 75 and the women below 80, because they have we have some data on this group of patients. And then we have the patient with pre-existing neuropathy, the patient frail, and the elderly, male over 75, female over 80, and those who are stage 3A or 3B. So stage 3A, the recommendation could be to treat this patient with fluoropyrimide alone because you are not sure to give them the 3% benefit. In patients with stage 3B, FOLFOX or Xelox, as well as the high-risk patients, and for the other, you go back to fluoropyrimide alone. And maybe in the future, we will have some new biomarker that maybe I will discuss just after that, like the recurrence score. So what some information on the ongoing trial that can change this. We know that the limitation for oxaliplatin-based therapy is the peripheral neuropathy. So it could be good to reduce the rate of neuropathy. We knew from all the trials that using 5-FU infusion for a short period of time could be an effective treatment. So it's why the idea meta-analysis is running in many parts of the world with several trials comparing the duration of chemotherapy. This will reduce the neuropathy and I hope to keep the effect of oxaliplatin-based therapy. So this is done in Italy with Tosca, in UK with Scott, in Japan, that started less than 1 year ago, in Greece with ORG, and in US with KGB, France, Gercor. In addition to this trial, some other trials are looking at other issues. One of the trials included in IDEA, the KGB trial, is looking at celecoxib or placebo. There is another trial done in Asia comparing aspirin to placebo in stage 2 and stage 3. There are trials running or starting looking at the exercise, the physical exercise to decrease the risk. And an SPP trial is looking at trials to avoid recurrence and the polyps. In Japan, they're using some kind of immunomodulator like the PSK. In UK, there is the CAPOX in rectal cancer. And in France, in patients with peritoneal carcinomatosis, there is a trial of laparotomy plus hyperthermia. We are also trying and looking to develop new biomarkers. And before the full classification that I will show later, we have some attempts like the Oncotype DX that have been developed with fluoropyrimidine, but is working well in patients with stage 3 with oxaliplatin-based chemotherapy. And we have also the guanylyl cyclase C among the candidate biomarkers that could be helpful. So I will not go back to the full classification of colon cancer. I don't know if it will be true in the adjuvant setting. We have learned from the past that to launch an adjuvant trial, we don't need to have the results of a metastatic trial in first-line therapy. This has been proven with irinotecan, with bevacizumab, at least. I want to do a trial using an anti-angiogenic agent after chemotherapy. I believe that this could be an important issue due to the dormancy effect. And to conclude, I go back to my algorithm. Thank you very much.